So what was it like breaking into the wrestling business in Calgary for you?
Well, it was very interesting. I left Phoenix, Arizona in 1970 in January. It was 75 degrees, which is a typical temperature day for Phoenix, being down here in the desert. And 2 days later, I was in Calgary. I'd driven up through the spine of the Rockies to get to Calgary, and it was they had an exceptional cold snap. It was 50 below zero. The next morning I woke up in the hotel. I had gone from 75 above to 50 below, and it was quite a shock. I remember walking to a store from the hotel. My nostrils would freeze. So it shut together. So it was really quite a shock. And I remember that Bob Luke, he played football for the Stampeders, the Calgary Stampeders. I tried out for the Calgary Stampeders myself the year before, and I actually was traded to the Montreal Alouettes and played some games for them, but my heart really wasn't in pro football. But I loved the city of Montreal and the beautiful women and in Montreal. But when I was invited to go up to become a professional wrestler and train by my friend Bob Luke, who played for the Stampeders, I was expecting to see a ring, a beautiful ring with I believe the symbol of Canada is the maple leaf, like a big maple leaf in the middle of the ring, and chairs around, and a nice looking workout area. And we pulled up to the house, the big mansion, and at nighttime it was freezing and snow, and I see all these cars around the yard. The hoods were up and flat tires on them, and it looked like a legitimate junkyard. And the house was this two or three story. It looked like something out of a fantasy book, like a mystery novel. And I remember we knocked on the door, and for my first workout and to meet Stu. And as we were knocking, the door bolted open, and three or four kids come running by us. They were chasing each other, and they were barefooted. They were barefooted. They were laughing and giggling and chasing each other. They were barefooted. They were running through the snow, and it was 50 degrees and below zero. And so we walked in, and Stu was in the process of cleaning up the dishes from the evening meal. And I thought he was just maybe a housekeeper. I didn't know that he was actually the guy that was going to train me. And so we walk in, and we meet, and we said, well, he said, well, let's go downstairs and let's go through a few things. And so I walked down to the dungeon, expecting to see this beautiful ring and all the things that go with it. And as I walked down the stairs, I see this disgusting room with these paper thin mats with blood stain on them, and the walls were grimy and oil soaked and blood splatter, and the low hanging pipes, some were with steam coming out, and there was a big box of rotting fruit that Stu had gone to these markets, and he had offered me some fruit, and he'd get this old fruit. They'd take off the racks before they'd dump them, and Stu would go by and bring them to the house. And it reminded me of the future Rolling Stones song "Beggar's Banquet." And I said, "No, I think I'll pass on the fruit." I said, "Are you going to train me?" And Bob Luke didn't smart me up. He didn't smart me up to a thing. And Stu looked at me and he said, "Well, you take off her jacket." I had a T-shirt on. He says, "You got some pretty big arms there." Bob Luke introduced me. My name is this is Wayne Coleman, and he wants to be a wrestler. And Stu says, "Well, boy, you got I won't try to impersonate him because I can't, but I think the Honky Tonk Man does the best job of impersonating. He's too hard." And so he said, I've never seen arms like this in my life. Look, your triceps look like horseshoes." And I said, "Well, thank you. I train pretty hard." I said, one of these nights, if you got enough weights, I saw some Olympic weights, a barbell set. I said, "If you got 600 pounds, I can bench press 600 pounds. And I could legit bench press 600 pounds. And he said, "Well, I'd love to see that." He said, and I'm still saying, I said, "Are you going to be my trainer?" It's too hard. And he has his street clothes on. And I said, we're not going to train tonight, right? I got sweatpants on. I was ready to train. And he said, "Sure." He said, let me see your neck." And I said, "What do you mean, let me see your neck?" He said, "Here, bend over here. Let me put you in a hold." And I thought he was just going to demonstrate. This was the beginning of my training process, and he was just going to demonstrate a hold on me. Well, I said, "Sure." So I bent over and stuck my neck out, and Stu immediately put a front face lock on me and cranked that thing up, and I could hear my neck snap, and it was like I just came from being a bouncer in a big bar in Phoenix where we beat the hell out of people, the drunks, and so I was used to fighting and getting roughed up a little bit, but all of a sudden I was in this front face lock that I found out later that was the name of the hold, and he was putting so much pressure on it that I dropped to my knees, and despite my strength, and he laid down on top of me with this front face lock, and I dropped to my knees in a prone position. I finally laid out flat, and I was going, "Oh my God, you're gonna break my neck. What are you doing?" I could barely utter these words. And I was strong enough that I was able to kind of do a push-up back up and stand up. And he held on to that thing for like 5 minutes. And so that was, finally he released it. He said, "Yeah, I just wanted to give you a little indication, little flavor of the wrestling business." And I said, "Well, I can't move my neck. my neck. I think you broke my neck." And then he went immediately right back to grabbing my triceps and squeezing my arms and saying, "I've never seen these." He said, "There's a famous Canadian weightlifter called Doug Hepburn." He said, "But I believe you dwarf him." And I said, "Yeah, I've heard of Doug Hepburn." I said, "I'm a lot stronger than Doug Hepburn." I had a little bit of an attitude. And I said, he said, "Well," he says, I said, I can't train anymore tonight." I said, I need to go to the doctor. No, I've x-rayed my neck. I think you did something to my neck. And he just kept squeezing my triceps and telling me he's never seen such arms in his life. Immediately, he was enamored with my 22-inch, legitimate 22-inch arms. And so one day led into the next day, and a couple days later, I said, I haven't had a workout. I need to do some bench pressing. So we got together all the weights, and he said, you told me, Coleman, he said, you told me you could bench press 600 pounds. I said, well, do you have 600 pounds of Olympic weights here? And he says, well, let's add it up. So we gathered together. Sure enough, he had about 650. So I worked my way up, and I popped out a couple of reps with 600 pounds on the bench press. From that point on, I think I became one of Stu's favorite wrestlers. He had me down there for about a week, and then decided to by the way, no one had smarted me up to wrestling yet. I was not told anything about how the business actually worked. And so my first match was in Calgary, first of all, he said, the first thing I want to do with you is send you all the way around the territory, and I want you to arm wrestle all comers. And I said, sure. I said, I can't be beaten arm wrestling, and I was a shooter in arm wrestling. I had beaten some guys in Los Angeles a couple years later who went to the Petaluma World Championships in California and shooting a big angle with Fred Blassie. And I had beaten some legitimate shooters. And so I was a heck of an arm wrestler. I was a real deal in arm wrestling. So I said, sure, I'll arm wrestle anybody. So that was the idea. He sent me around the whole entire territory, arm wrestling all comers, and there was no shortage of them. These farmers would get up in the ring, and I'd break their arms. I'd put their arms down, smash it down to the table. So three or four guys in a row, and so we made the whole loop. And then I was still doing a little bit of training in the locker rooms on the road, trying to learn how to be a wrestler. And so we get to the point where it's time for me to have my first run in during a match. And the Christie brothers were wrestling someone, and Stu took me off to the side, and they're in the Calgary arena. And he said, the bell had rung, and he said, no. He said, run in there and attack one of those Christie brothers. And I said, Stu, I can't go in the ring. I said, the bell's rung. The match has started. No one has smarted me up yet. And he said, Coleman, I told you to get your ass in there and attack the Christie brothers. Go in there and throw some punches and some kicks. I said, I can't. The bell has rung. And so he grabbed me and drug me back into the locker room, and he said, Coleman, you're going to do what I tell you to do. And I said, well, I will do what you tell me to do, but I can't interfere in the match. He said, well, why don't you guys tell me how this thing works? Nobody has smarted me up yet. And so finally they smarted me up to the deal, and I start riding around this vast wilderness, these endless miles. And I'll never forget one day riding with Wild Bill Dromo, and I saw on his sun visor these family photos that were paper clipped and some were pinned to the headliner, and that was his family back down in Georgia, and here we are out in the wilderness of ice and snow, driving to some town, and I said to myself, I said, is this my fate? Am I going to end up like this guy, away from my family, in out here in the wilderness, in the freezing weather, and my children and my wife are back in the United States? I said, no, it is not. I was talking to myself. I said, I will not end up like this. And so I found that very, very, very depressing. And then they, Abdullah the Butcher and I became pretty good buddies. We started riding in the back seat together, making the rounds. And Abby was the one who actually smarted me up. He started telling me about how the thing works, how everything works. I said, Butcher. I said, I don't know how this thing works. No one's telling me anything here. I'm learning on the go. And he always called me Coleman. He said, Coleman, he said, this is how it works. He says, we do this thing here, but we try to make it look real, but we don't want to hurt each other, because if we hurt each other, this is a quote from Abdullah the Butcher. He says, if we hurt each other, we won't be able to wrestle. So the thing is, the wrestling is fake. We want to make it look real, but we don't want to hurt each other because we'll be out of a job. And so I said, well, that makes sense to me. So how do you do it without hurting each other? They had literally, no one had told me anything. So Abdullah was the one who took me under his wing and smarted me up to everything, and we became the best of friends. And eventually, I caught on, and Abdullah, they found out that I could talk a little bit. I found out that I could talk a little bit on a microphone during an interview. And so Stu said, I'm going to have you talk for Abdullah. And so I started doing some interviews in the ring for Abdullah the Butcher, and it came pretty natural for me. And Abdullah the Butcher said, he said, I got a great idea. He said, Coleman, he said, I think we can make you a baby face. He said, you can bench 600 pounds, right? I said, yeah. He said, well, what we need to do is let me talk to Stu and have you put on a bench pressing exhibition, and I'll spot you. And then when we get up to 600 pounds and I'm handing it off to you, I'll dump it. I'll dump the 600 pounds on you, and of course the plates will fall off the bar. And he says, I'll pick up a 50-pound plate and hit you in the head, and then I'll gig you, and then you'll be a baby face, and then we can have matches. We can work against each other. And I said, are you crazy? You want to dump 600 pounds of real weight on top of me, and then you want to hit me in the head with a 50-pound plate? You could give me a concussion. You could break my skull open. And then you want to run a razor blade across my head and cut my head open? I said, you're crazy, Abdullah. And that very night, as we were talking that over, I had driven up to Calgary in a beautiful Cadillac that somehow I managed to get some fake credit for from Phoenix. And I brought a big, beautiful television that I had stolen out of a motel in Phoenix, and I sold it to Stu Hart. And I walked out. I was 6 months behind on my payment, and I walked out, and all of us to the spot where my Cadillac was parked and was empty. And I said, "Oh my God, they repossessed my Caddy." And Abdul the Butcher just bowed over laughing. I said, "They got me." I said, "Abby, they got me, brother. They took my Caddy." And he laughed at me all night long. And he bowled over laughing. "Oh man, they repoed your Caddy, Coleman. That's the funniest thing I've ever seen." Stu Hart had troubles with his television one day, and he called out the TV repairman. TV repairman started to go to work on the television, a beautiful television, a big, big television. And as he started taking the back of the television apart, he saw these numbers that were burned by a soldering iron into the television. And the TV repairman told Stu, said, "Stu, you have a stolen television here on your hands." He said, "What do you mean?" He said, "You see these numbers that are soldered in?" He says, these are serial numbers. This television came out of a hotel." And it did. I stole it from a hotel. And I sold the stew for $200. And the guy says, "I'm going to go ahead and fix it anyway because it's from the United States and they'll never know it." But Stu, the next couple days later, said, "Coleman, you sold me a television. The guy said you stole from a hotel room." I said, "Yeah, I did. I stole it, Stu. I was a thief. I said, I'd steal anything that wasn't glued down, man. And I took the TV and I needed the $200, so you got a stolen TV. How do you like that?" And that was the beginning of my deal with Abdullah and Stu.
Okay, can you describe to us what a typical Abdullah the Butcher match is like?
Well, I saw Abdullah the Butcher almost decapitate an Indian in Lethbridge, the city of Lethbridge, Canada. Abdullah was the main event, but this was the second match on the card, and I saw him cut this Indian, and they gave the Indian $15 for the match, and Abdullah showed me his blade. He used like a popsicle stick, and he would tape the blade to the popsicle stick. And I was watching him, and I just watched him. And he went out there at the second match, and when he got in the ring, he just grabbed the Indian, and he just started slicing this Indian's face up, and his neck, and his shoulders, and my God, it was like manslaughter. And 30 seconds later, it was over. And we went back to the locker room, and I get back there, and I see this Indian standing there covered with blood from his head to his wrestling boots, literally covered in blood. And he was a dark-skinned Indian, and he was starting to turn white from losing blood. And I said, "This guy is going to die. You people better call." They didn't call them paramedics back then. It was just an ambulance. I said, "You better call an ambulance because this guy is going to die. He's going to lose all of his blood." And so they did. They did call an ambulance. And they stopped the bleed. They wrapped him up while they waiting for the ambulance. He was covered with his blood. And I said, "Butcher, Abby, I said, "Why'd you cut this guy up so bad for? He's a Coleman. I had to get my heat, baby. I said, "What do you mean?" He said, "Well, I'm in the main event." I said, and he said, "Me cutting up this Indian put some heat on me." And I said, "Well, yeah, you better hope the guy doesn't die because you'll go to jail for murder." He just laughed at me, and so it was literally a massacre that I watched before my very eyes. I never had seen anything like this. It was chilling. It was absolutely chilling just to see him stand in this ring and start slicing another man. It was like something you'd see in a movie. It was like an assault, like maybe the mafia is gonna kill you or something, a hitman. And it actually kind of scared me a little bit, you know? And Abby just laughed it off. He says, "I gotta get my heat, Coleman. I gotta get my heat." I said, "Well, you got the heat all right. Let's just hope the guy doesn't die." And so he didn't die. And as they were, the ambulance crew were putting him on the gurney and all wrapped up in towels, they stuffed the $15 as payoff underneath the towel underneath his head. "Oh, here's your $15. And that was the last we saw of the Indian.
So when Abdullah would cut people like that in matches, would he usually have their permission to do that, or would that kind of be a surprise to them in the course of the match?
Oh, I believe that when I of course I would watch the matches because I had to learn what was going on, so I wanted to watch the matches anyway. But when he would get someone on a lower end person, he'd cut them without their permission. But he would not cut the main event opponent like a Billy Robinson or a David Rule or one of the main event people without their permission. But he would definitely cut up some of the lower opening card guys. They seem to do that every now and then, throw a guy out there so Abby could slice him up to get some heat. And it was just like a butcher shop. And so I guess that's why he got his name, Abdullah the Butcher. It's like he was butchering people up. But he never did it to the main event people, unless it was a predetermined angle set up to get some juice. That never happened, no.
Taping a razor blade through his finger?
No. Abdullah used the popsicle stick on himself. I as far as I can remember, I never saw him. Now he could have, but my recollection is that he would use this blade taped to the popsicle stick on himself also. Now he could have later on, because I wasn't with him all those years, you know, he could have advanced to maybe taping it to his finger or something, but the times I saw him cut himself, it was like he was slicing his forehead with that blade taped to the popsicle stick.
Okay, so that was more at the start of his career. So I don't know if you've heard or not, but WWE is inducting Abdullah into the Hall of Fame this year, and obviously he should be in because he's a legend, but do you think it's hypocritical at all that WWE is inducting him when they have a policy on no blood in matches?
Inducting who into the Hall of Fame?
Abdullah. They're inducting Abdullah in this year. And I'm just wondering if you feel that it's hypocritical of WWE to induct a guy that's known for only having bloody matches when WWE currently has a no-blood policy.
I don't believe so because this was years ago that Abdullah did all of this cutting, and I believe that Abdullah should be in a Hall of Fame without question, and there is nothing sacred about professional wrestling or the Hall of Fame or anything else, and so I think they're waving his past bloodletting and slaughtering people because they're running out of people, I think, to induct into the Hall of Fame. And I think Abdullah should be in the Hall of Fame, and despite their current policy of no blading. And by the way, the only reason that Vince adopted and put into play the policy of no more blood was not because of the potential hepatitis C or HIV or any other blood contaminated exchange of diseases. It wasn't out of compassion for the wrestlers and their safety. It was because his wife, Linda McMahon, was running for public office. And so he had to clean up his act. And at the same time, he stopped the blading. She knew she was going to be running for office, and so he instituted this policy. Also, the girls became more a little more covered up, and there was no more blood. And so this was all not out of compassion or concern for the health or safety of the wrestlers. It was because his wife was running for political office, and you cannot convince me otherwise, because I know this man, and he doesn't care if you catch hepatitis C or HIV or you get some sort of a disease from blading. He doesn't care. He doesn't care. He doesn't care for you. In that regards, it was strictly a political move to enhance Linda McMahon's image to become an official in the government in the United States.
So what kind of a message do you think it sends, like, young wrestlers to put a guy like Abdullah in the Hall of Fame? Because he's never been in WWE. And he did all this blading and this type of stuff, and he's getting in the Hall of Fame now. But even though WWE has the no-blood policy, this kind of sends a message that to a young wrestler that wants to get famous, they can still do the blood and stuff in other territories and still have the potential to get in the Hall of Fame down the road. What do you think about that, like, for the message that it sends?
Well, I think, like I said, they're really running out of people to induct into the Hall of Fame. And I don't believe that they're sending a message that it's okay to blade yourself by inducting Abdullah. I think that they're taking advantage of the fact that the man is in Atlanta and that he is a legitimate legend. And I don't see personally any correlation with future young wrestlers who would admire Abdul the Butcher for cutting himself so many times and still being inducted into the Hall of Fame. I really don't see a connection there, honestly.
Okay. So, you actually wrestled Abdullah a couple of times in Florida, at least one time in Miami in the 80s. After seeing what you saw in Lethbridge and knowing his reputation, were you at all worried going into the match that he was going to cut you?
Oh, no. I've actually wrestled Abdullah probably a half a dozen times because I wrestled him in some independent shows up around New Jersey as well, with maybe 50 people in a gymnasium. And by this time, you've got to realize Abdullah and I became very close friends, very, very, very close friends. And by now, I had already been the WWF champion. I had become very famous, very successful. I am now no longer Wayne Coleman. I'm superstar Billy Graham. I am a legend, an icon almost in the business, and we were very close friends, and he had total respect for me as far as my professional career, and also we had a real friendship. We were really friends, and there was never even a second thought that Abby would try to blade me, because he knew that I was at last smart, and if he tried to blade me, I'd kick him in the groin and take the blade away from him and blade him right back. So no, I never had any fear or concern. And we always laughed during our matches and had a lot of fun with each other. But on a couple of independent shows, with the Road Warriors being the main event, Abby and I wrestled against each other. He actually bladed himself during the match to really get the match over. And no, he didn't come near me, and we had a couple of girlfriends that lived together in Calgary that we were living with each other, with the girls, and we shared the girls, and Abby and I had a very special relationship, but I never crossed my mind for one minute, and he never attempted to. I never even thought, it wouldn't even cross his mind, I don't believe, for one minute, to blame me. If we wanted to get juice in a match, I was perfectly capable at this point of blading myself. And I wouldn't let anybody, of course, blame me anyway. You know, I mean, that was unacceptable. He had bladed himself in a couple of those matches. He was pretty addicted to blading, and he had bladed himself a couple of times, but I never saw the need to get juice in an independent show with a handful of folks out there watching. I didn't see the need to produce any blood. But Abby kind of enjoyed blading. I think he enjoyed it.
So before diseases like hepatitis C and HIV became known, was sharing blades and reusing blades pretty common practice in the wrestling business?
I never shared a blade. I was always Even in my drug consumption, I always use my uppers and downers and steroids, everything, was pharmaceutical drugs. And I was very, very, very conscious. I would never let anyone come near me with a razor blade. I saw Dr. Jerry Graham when we first were tag team together in Los Angeles, after we wrestled on the Indian reservation, the Navajo Indian reservation in Arizona, for the first time, he said Coleman, he said the Indians are easy. He said all they need is a little bit of juice. He said give them a little bit of blood. I said, well, I don't know how to make a razor blade. And he said, well, here, I'll show you. And so he made up a little blade for me. And he said, let's just give him some, all we gotta do is give him a little bit of blood. We had two single matches, and then we came back in a tag match. And that was the extent of the card on the Navajo Indian Reservation, and the Indians loved it. And I did my first blade job on a Navajo Indian reservation in really a beautiful government-built auditorium, and with about 300 Indians in it. They loved wrestling. And I did my first blade job in front of the Navajo Indians, and I was convinced that I had cut my head halfway off and leaving the ring and walking back to the locker room, that I was leaving a torrent, a trail of blood that was... I was sure that I was just bleeding to death. And when I got back in the locker room and looked in the mirror, it was barely a trickle coming down. But Jerry Graham had really cut himself seriously, and he used these dirty razor blades over and over. I saw him look through his bag in Bakersfield against the match against John Tolis. I was watching him. They wanted Jerry to get juice, and I saw Jerry going through his bag. He said, I got a blade in here somewhere. And he found the blade, and then he got the blade ready. And then during the match, while Tolis was pounding away on him, Jerry Graham had this way of cutting his head. He cut himself very slowly. He would put his left forearm up to kind of conceal it. Then he'd take his right hand with the blade and just go from right to left horizontally across his forehead very slowly, instead of doing it quick so nobody could see you. He had this very slow, methodical way of cutting his head open. And he taught me, it was very odd that a man that could care less about cutting his head open told me that you always want to cut your head with the lines of your forehead so it looks natural, so the scar tissue will blend in with the natural horizontal lines of your forehead, as opposed to people like Abdul the Butcher or Joe LeDuc, who did the vertical cutting and looked like monsters with these huge gashes in their foreheads. I actually was astounded that Jerry Graham gave me these words of wisdom to cut your head horizontally so you couldn't see the scar tissue. It was astounding to hear that come from a man who would pull a dirty razor blade out of his back and just cut his head wide open, that he would be concerned about not creating scar tissue on his forehead. It was quite the words of wisdom, you know, coming from a man who sadly had a nervous breakdown when his mother died in Phoenix right before I went to Calgary, and he went into the hospital with a gun, pulled on the doctors. When they called him and told him his mother had passed away, and he went into the hospital and grabbed his mother, his dead, poor dead mother, and pulled the gun on the doctors and put her over his shoulder, walked out with his dead mother out of the hospital, and put her in the front seat of his car and drove away with his dead mother. And of course this made the news, and they had 100 policemen going after him, and finally he pulled over and he apologized. He said, "I just lost my mother." And they said, "Well, but sir, you can't go in the hospital and pull a gun on doctors, you know, and threaten to kill them if they don't give you your mother back." And so there were obviously some psychological damage for him to pull a stunt like that. And then we had met after that, and convinced me to go wrestle on the Indian reservations with him.
So what makes you think that you caught hepatitis C from double blood matches?
Well, I have a photograph right now I'm holding up for the camera. There probably is some glare on it. It's a cowbell match in the garden with Dusty. And we got a double juice deal going on, and I'll leave these with you so you can reshoot them. But we both have blood going on here, and the doctors at the Mayo Clinic here in Phoenix, who did my liver transplant, are convinced that they actually coined a new phrase because of my, usually you get hepatitis C through the sharing of needles is the common way. But when I came on the scene as a pro wrestler and revealed to them that we cut our heads with razor blades and we bleed on each other, they coined the phrase commingling of blood. And they are convinced, since I have been so aware of never sharing a needle for a steroid injection, and everything was, I was really a sterile person, that the bleeding, the commingling of blood, this is coming from the scientific studies of the Mayo Clinic Hospital, and that's a scary thing, because the photograph I'm looking at here of Dusty and I in the cowbell match, both of our eyes, of course, are full of blood, let alone the opening of the wounds. I'm bleeding into him, and he's bleeding into me, and so we have a commingling of blood into open wounds. And hepatitis C can lay dormant for decades before it finally kicks in and starts to do its damage. And I know that my good friend Kevin Sullivan, you wonder, you ask the question, it makes you think, well, who in the world would have hepatitis C? Is there a certain look to a person? Well, I was listening to Kevin Sullivan 2 years ago giving an interview back east at a fan convention I was at, and he was telling the story about an independent show he was at, and the promoter told him, I want you to get juice, and I want your opponent to get juice. And he said to the promoter, I don't want that guy bleeding on me. And that inspired the catchphrase I'm holding up now before the camera, a t-shirt that I had made that says, don't bleed on me. And I used the hand, I'm an artist, and I painted the hand of Adam reaching out to God on the top of the Sistine Chapel, and I put a razor blade on the finger with blood dripping down into a ocean of blood washing up against the forearm of the image for the t-shirt that says, don't bleed on me. And he told the promoter, he said, because that guy is on meth, he's on heroin, and he's taking every drug known to mankind, and I don't want his blood on me. And he says, well, you don't have any choice, because I'm the promoter and I want double juice. So Kevin Sullivan said he got the juice first, and then as soon as his opponent, I won't use the guy's name, I don't want to embarrass him. It would not be fair, because people would recognize his name. And as soon as his opponent got juice, Kevin left the ring immediately and was counted out. He didn't want a drop of his blood on him. So this brings you to the question, is there an appearance, is there a certain type of look that would suspect or make you think a person has hepatitis C? Well, this person looked like he definitely could have some diseases. But here's the paradox of the answer. Here I am, superstar Billy Graham, hygienically clean person, sterile person, always clean, always dressed clean, always looking bodybuilder, never a dirty person. Always took care of myself, always clean, yet I have hepatitis C. So you have a major problem here. You cannot, just by looking at a person, say, I bet, well, obviously we kind of think that a person that is missing all of his teeth is on meth, and we know that certain people use a lot of drugs so they could have some health issues. But if you look at superstar Billy Graham and my dear friend Road Warrior Hawk, who had hepatitis C and then went on interferon for 6 months, which I'm going to start next month. He did a 6-month run of interferon and put hepatitis C into remission. So we have a problem here of trying to determine who has and who doesn't have a disease by appearance only.
So you mentioned Road Warrior Hawk has it. I heard Bob Orton Jr. has it. Is there anyone else that you know of in the wrestling business that actually commits to having it?
I don't know I don't stay in contact. I don't talk wrestling with people. I find that I've done it all. I've seen it all. What else can you show me? I'm not entertained by the business. I don't watch Raw. I don't watch TNA. I've done it all. I've seen it all. I find it basically boring, and so I don't stay in touch with anyone currently. I did a beautiful portrait of Terry Funk that I gave him 2 years ago when Kevin Sullivan told this story about not bleeding on me, and. And Hillbilly Jim is probably my closest friend, and we only talk about every 3 or 4 months, so I don't keep up with what's going on. So now we know that the decade of the 70s were bloodbath years. Every wrestling magazine you pick up has got blood on it. We all were bleeders, and I found out, like most people do who have hepatitis C, I found out accidentally that I had it because I was getting ready for a hip replacement surgery, and to be cautious, I was going to give 2 units, which I did, of my own blood, so in case I needed blood during surgery, I wouldn't have to go to the hospital blood bank to get blood, because they did. I don't think they started testing for hepatitis C until 1992, and my first hip replacement was 1987, and so it was at this time that when I donated my own blood for possible transfusion during surgery, they discovered that I had hepatitis C. Now, it had been laying dormant, and there were no, I had no, at this point, I had no ill side effects from it because it hadn't kicked in. The virus was dormant and hadn't started destroying the tissue yet. But nevertheless, it was still in me. So that is the problem with all of the blading and hepatitis C. It can lay dormant for 2 decades before it kicks in and starts doing damage to your liver.
Okay, so you do believe that probably there's other wrestlers from the 70s and 80s that would have it, but they just either haven't come out publicly about it or don't know about it.
Oh, I believe without a doubt that other wrestlers from that era and even wrestlers now who've been in double juice matches have hepatitis C and maybe something else. I mean, blood-borne diseases, when you're co-mingling, when you cut your head open, and I cut my head open, and we bleed into each other, and my blood goes into your bloodstream, whatever I have, you now have it. And so sometimes, like I said, it doesn't show up for decades. And you don't know you have it unless you get a blood test until symptoms start appearing. And then you go find out why you're feeling sick and lethargic. and why your stool is turning gray and why you're losing your appetite and what's going on here. And you start showing symptoms, and then you find out that you have hepatitis C. So I believe there is a multitude of wrestlers who have hepatitis C that are not aware of it because it has not shown up yet in a blood test.
Now, can you explain as briefly as possible what hepatitis C is exactly and what it does to you?
Yes, I have a photograph of my liver. I'm holding up now before the camera, and there is some glare in the room, so you might want to reshoot it. But hepatitis C creates cirrhosis of the liver, and cirrhosis is basically scar tissue. And Kevin Sullivan, when I sent him this photograph of my liver, he said, "This photograph of your liver looks like the face of the devil." That is a quote from Kevin Sullivan. "It is the most disgusting looking image you will ever see. There's nodules, the scar tissue. It's full of, it was the size of a basketball when they pulled it out of me." And I actually went to the lab about 5 days later and pulled my own liver in my own hands. And the doctor told me, who did the transplant, that I had about a small handful of living cells left in my liver, and that I was 30 days away from dying when I got my liver transplant. And we are conducting this interview just mere blocks away from the young girl that was in a car wreck and was a donor. And I received her liver, and her family is barely 15 minutes from us, from where we're conducting this interview, and she died on this freeway that we can see from this shooting area here in the hotel. She died not more than a stone's throw from where we're doing this very interview, and she had signed her donor's card when she was 16 years old. And so she died. They kept her alive, and they went over and they got her liver, they got her heart, her lungs, her spleen. And so I encourage everyone to sign your donor cards and become a donor, because you could possibly save somebody's life. My life was saved by this young girl who had the presence of mind and belief in her heart that she should be a donor when she was 16 years old. She signed her driver's license to be a donor, and she saved my life.
Now, you were talking before about people that are likely to have hepatitis C. A guy like Abdullah, who's been wrestling since 1958, has had double blood matches almost every night of his career. Do you think he would be a likely person to possibly have it?
He could have contracted it maybe 20 years ago, and as they say, it lays dormant sometimes for a good 20 years. And so it still has a chance of popping up. He may have it.
Well, I have a little bit of a story to tell you of why I'm so interested in hepatitis C. It's actually because I caught it myself from wrestling, and I was offered a WWE contract in 2009, and it was rescinded because they wouldn't hire me because I had hepatitis C. Now, I've only had double blood matches with one guy in my career, and that's Abdullah the Butcher. And he actually cut me. Kai has the video of it for you that he can show you. But I was just wondering if you could watch the video and comment on if, from the way he cut me in the video, you think I could have possibly got it from him. Because I'm a young guy, I'm only 28. Don't do any drugs. Never use a needle or anything. And then I magically have it after wrestling Abdullah's Butcher. I don't believe there's any other way I could have caught it.
I would be happy to, and if that's the case,
By the way, I also went through one treatment already, 1 6-month treatment, and it was horrible. I lost 35 pounds.
One treatment of what?
I went on interferon and ribavirin treatment.
Yes.
And it didn't work, and it was, I had much more than flu-like symptoms. I lost 35 pounds, I was 280. With, I lost all my muscle. It was horrible. I experienced severe depression. I got rashes. It was absolutely terrible. So hopefully you'll have a better experience on treatment than I did.
Yes, and what you're saying is true. Some people do have horrible side effects from the interferon treatments. It's almost like the luck of the draw. And some people, the side effects are so bad, which you just described, makes them stop taking interferon because they cannot stand the side effects.
My doctor, I was supposed to do 24 weeks, and my doctor took me off after 19 weeks. I was negative while I was on the treatment, and the doctor thought that I would continue to be negative. So we thought the side effects were worse than keeping me on the treatment for the last 5 weeks. But when they did the 6 month post-treatment blood test, they found that it was bad.
Well, you may not have the favorable gene type also, which does come into play. That may be part of the problem of your lack of success is the gene type that that they have discovered don't respond well to interferon compared to the other genome types that do respond very well to interferon. And this is a proven medical fact that they have discovered, and so you might want to look into your genome, your gene type, and then see if that gene type is compatible or evidently it was not compatible with the ribavirin and the interferon. You may have been just sadly cursed with the wrong gene type, because that does play a big role in the success of the interferon treatments.
Okay, well, Kai, can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear. I got the video over here.
And
if you just want to hold that.
This is just a video of one of the matches we had, but I just wanted you to comment on this video specifically and say, like, if you believe if Abdullah did have hepatitis C, if he could have passed it to me this way.
I'm watching your match now.
So in this match, Abdullah had blade taped to his finger, as you can see.
Yes, I'm seeing him blading himself now. Oh, and now I see him cutting your forehead like tapping you on the forehead. With the same, okay, I see your blood. Yes, there's no question about it that how long ago was that match?
That match was 2007, and Abdullah is the only person that cut me, and he certainly, as you can see by that tape, I was already bleeding. Like, he just went over and above me blading myself and decided to slice me those other four or five times.
Oh, yes, I can see that. That was quite obvious. And sometimes hepatitis C will show up rather quickly, but also, like I said, it can lay dormant for decades before it starts doing any damage also. And so now what do they plan on doing?
Now I pretty much just box until a new medication come out, because they won't put me back on interferon. Because the side effects are bad and it didn't work, so they don't feel that interferon will ever work for me. But they do say that new drugs are being developed, and I'm not going to die anytime soon. I have about 10 years or so before the effects really start to show.
Well, I have some very good news for you. I've been in touch with the I don't know if I'm pronouncing it, the Ibex Corporation in Atlanta, who have received a patent on a new anti-hepatitis C drug, and is going to be released in November. They got all the information, I believe, from Belgium, came up with the combination of the anti-hepatitis C drug, and the I will send you the name of the drug company that's developing it now. And they asked me, they sent me a questionnaire. I spoke to the vice president of the company in Atlanta, and they their results so far have been 100%, despite what genome type you are, of putting the hepatitis C into remission. And they feel that this is finally the miracle drug to suppress hepatitis C permanently in your system, and is due to be released in November. And they've actually, the company, like I said, I'm not pronouncing it, the Ibex, Inbex, something like that. I'll send you the I'll email you the letter that I received from them for their new anti-hepatitis C drug that they feel is now finally the cure-all once and for all to put hepatitis C into remission. And they've been doing testing, and every test they've done has proved successful. And they feel that they have got the right combination, and that as I've mentioned, the U.S. government has issued them a patent to produce this drug and distribute this drug in the United States, and it's just a matter of some more testing to go through. I volunteered for some of the testing, but was disqualified because I've had a liver transplant, and that was one of the disqualification issues, and a few other issues I've had that were minor that disqualified me from participating in the actual testing of this new drug. But I will forward you the letter that was sent to me via email from the vice president of the drug company that has the patent on this drug, and they are convinced that finally this will be the cure for hepatitis C, and that they're going to release the drug. All their testing will be finished, and it will be released by November. Now, it could be 2 or 3 more months past that by the time they get all their ducks in a row. But at this stage, every test they have done has proven successful. Thank God that you're still a young man, and that you will be probably when this drug hits the market, I'm sure you will be one of the first people to take it, because they are convinced that they have finally unlocked the key, the mystery to hepatitis C with this new drug, and it will put it into remission forever.
The worst part about it is I lost my contract over it, so I'm stuck doing normal jobs until this thing gets out of my system.
You lost your contract with the WWE.
Yeah, when they found, because now they test you for it before you get hired.
Well, that's fine, but once the new drug comes out and they are aware of the new drug, and you come up testing negative, surely they will take another look at your case and reconsider, reevaluate you, and once they find out the success and the miracle success of this new drug, and that you report in with a drug test of zero hepatitis C virus in your blood system, that will qualify you to give you another shot at the WWE, I would think.
Maybe just a comment on the likelihood. I mean, after seeing the video, after knowing, you know, the era that Abdullah comes from, in your opinion, is it possible that he may have contracted it from Abdullah? Is the question that we're trying to answer, because
yeah, I didn't understand.
Abdullah has agreed to give blood work, and it's been ongoing with lawyers, but he keeps dodging it, essentially.
Has he given blood work?
No, he hasn't.
My lawyer met with him, and he said it'd be no problem. He would give blood work within the next 2 weeks. This was in September. Then she left him 2 voicemails. He never responded. Then he was sent 2 formal letters by an actual person from the court that people at his restaurant had signed for, and he ignored those letters.
Oh, well, then that's obvious that he's dodging taking the test. This is quite obvious. I think it's personally, I think it's despicable what I just saw on the videotape of what he did to you. I find it abhorrent that he would just, I saw it myself in 1970. What he did to the Indian in Canada. Personally, what I saw in the videotape what I saw Abdullah doing to Devon Nicholson, intentionally, purposely blading him repeatedly over and over and over, is despicable and unacceptable in this day and age, and shows total disregard for human life and human health, and is unacceptable, and he should actually be banned from further competition, from further matches in professional wrestling, for what he did intentionally, purposely, predeterminedly. By the way, he knew he was going to do this to you in the locker room, and that that he should be sued, and should be every legal avenue should be followed and followed up on, because I think it's a crime to mutilate someone like that, and now dodging, taking the test for hepatitis A and dodging the official documentation letters to you and your attorney. I think that it is absolutely unacceptable in this day and age that he is allowed to get away with this, and that there should be legal repercussions. And I would advise Devon Nicholson to keep pursuing this legal avenue, and put Abdullah the Butcher against the wall, and get some direct answers, and get a blood test, and get something official to end this this diabolical thing that I just witnessed, a totally diabolical attack on you, on Devon, is unacceptable, and it has to stop. And I am appalled and sickened by it, and it's totally unacceptable. And I think that Devon should pursue again the full extent of the law in his pursuit of his civil rights being abused, and contracting a deadly disease, and it had to come from the repeated repetition of pounding of that blade into Devon's forehead from the video that I've seen. It had to have come from that, since he is a non-drug user and is a healthy human being in every respect, in every regards. This is the only possibility, and the doctors, again, at the Mayo Clinic Hospital that did my liver transplant, are convinced beyond a shadow of a doubt that the commingling of blood is you can only get hepatitis C through blood. And so there's a major issue here, and I pray that it is settled and it will be in Devon's favor.
Thank you, that's perfect. Can you just explain, like, you see that he had the tape to his finger there? Can you just explain to the camera how someone would do it if they were to tape a blade to their finger like that?
He wants you to demonstrate, without having the tape and the blade, how... because in the video you can see that his hand is taped with the blade. He's been, yeah. So if you can maybe just demonstrate with your hand how someone would have done it.
Yeah, it's a very simple process. of taping a razor blade to your finger is not science. We don't need an Einstein to figure it out. You simply take athletic tape and tape the razor blade to your finger, which is in my painting. You see the tape on my finger in this painting, and it's a simple matter of taping a razor blade around your finger to secure the razor blade, and then keep the razor blade tip covered up with another piece of tape until it's time to actually use the blade, and then possibly peel that piece of tape back and then start pecking away and cutting away. It's not brain surgery. You simply tape a razor blade to your finger and you use it and you start cutting people with it. And it's as simple as that. You just tape it like you're taping up for a, if you had bad breaks in your hand, you want to be an MMA fight, you want to go out there and fight, or a football player, you simply tape up, you tape your ankles up, you tape your wrists up, you simply tape the blade in circles around and secure it to your finger, and there it is. The blade is taped to your fingers and taped to your hand, and you simply use it, and it's as simple as that. It's not brain surgery.
All right, I have one final question for you. WWE and the big companies like us to think that wrestling is just entertainment and there shouldn't be commissions overseeing it or anything. But do you think that wrestling really should be regulated, because clearly stuff like you just saw in this video is still going on, and do you think it should be regulated to protect the wrestlers? So obviously the promoters don't care.
Oh, there's no question. There's no question that someone needs to step up to regulate things of this nature, because it's appalling to allow this type of carnage to go on in this country unregulated. And of course there should be Congress should step in and do some sort of passing of laws or something to stop independent promoters, people who are still using these razor blades to produce blood. It is unacceptable with the knowledge that we have now of the transmission of blood-borne diseases, and that it's allowed to continue unabated in this country. There has to be, but we know that the United States does not care in the least. That is the least of this country's worries, is our professional wrestlers cutting their heads with razor blades. They have priorities in this country of people being out of work and gas going sky high, and people starving and losing their jobs, and that is the bottom of their list. And it would take a major. They have got the senators and these people, the lawmakers of the United States of America, have got paperwork 10 feet high of things, priorities, bridges to be built, highways to be repaired, buildings to be built, jobs to create, people to feed, all kinds of priorities, as opposed to a handful in proportion to the over 300 million people that live in the United States, a handful of people who were cutting themselves with razor blades. They just simply do not care.
So would you advise anyone that's been in a double blood match to get themselves tested, not just if they've wrestled Abdullah, but if they've wrestled anyone in a double blood match, because you really could never guess who has it, who doesn't.
You mean advise them to get tested now?
Yeah.
Oh, of course. Of course, immediately. If you've ever been involved in a match where both opponents have bled on each other, anybody nowadays, any wrestler should immediately go down and get tested for hepatitis C.
That they know the story and they're still putting him in the Hall of Fame makes me even madder. Because it's basically saying they don't care about what he did to me.
Exactly right, and that is par for the course with Vince McMahon. That's what I said earlier. The only reason he stopped it was because Linda was running for office. He does not care about the health of the participants. He stopped double juicing. He stopped blood because his wife was running for an office in the Senate or the Congress or whatever she was running for, so he had to clean up his act. It wasn't out of compassion for the wrestlers.
It's insulting. You would think at least knowing the story about me, and they did really want to hire me, that they would at least not induct him.
Oh.
I'm sure he's done this to more people than me, and like, obviously, most people won't come out about this, but I have nothing to lose anymore. I already lost my contract. So I don't care if people know that I have it.
Exactly. I understand exactly. Now, and you're not concerned about... obviously, this will seal your doom with any future contract with Vince... when this hits, because of this strong stand against inducting Abdullah the Butcher and the blood expose,
just to make change for the future, is to prevent this.
And it really has to get out there because Abdullah is still wrestling, and probably a lot of other people that have it are still wrestling, and it's getting passed around. And
of course, it's getting passed around. As I said, it can lay dormant for 2 decades. Before it shows up, before you even know it, it can lay there and not do a single thing to you for 20 years. Of course more people have it. Certainly they do. They just don't know it because they haven't had a blood test.
And they don't think about it, because when you're cutting in the ring, usually you're just thinking about the damage that the physical cuts are doing. You're not thinking about transmission.
Oh, no, you're not thinking about contracting a disease. No, of course not. No.
I'm ready with the other tape if you want to re-ask the induction question.
I'll ask the question again. What kind of message do you think WWE is sending by inducting Abdullah the Butcher in the Hall of Fame with WWE knowing the story of why Devin Nicholson did not get his contract?
Knowing the story of Devin?
So now, after what you know, Devin's story, what are your thoughts of the WWE inducting someone that is so known for bloody matches?
Yes. Now that I'm fully aware of the fact that the WWE is fully aware of Abdullah the Butcher's continuing to cut people open and have double blood matches, and despite this fact, their knowing complete knowledge of this fact, that he continues to do it and will continue to do it. They are hypocritical, total hypocrites in inducting him into the Hall of Fame, and there's no way on God's earth with this reputation and the video that I have seen and the continuing of cutting people's head open intentionally, and the full knowledge that the WWE has of Abdullah's practices of doing this in the ring, inducting them into the Hall of Fame, makes them the biggest hypocrites on the face of the earth and makes the Hall of Fame a joke. And they should be embarrassed to the max over disregarding the absolute despicable act of violence that Abdullah the Butcher has done, is doing, and will continue to do with this knowledge, and inducting him into their Hall of Fame makes it a total sham and is absolutely unacceptable. And they should be ashamed of themselves by deceiving the general public and the fans at large by ignoring Abdullah the Butcher's intentional blading of other wrestlers and blading of himself, when they have a policy of no blood, no blading, and they know fully, and they are fully aware of the fact that he continues to do this to this very day. It is unacceptable for him to go into the WWE Hall of Fame, and it makes their Hall of Fame a sham. It is quite obvious that Abdullah the Butcher's reputation of cutting people, starting with my first vision of him slicing a poor Indian off a reservation nearly to death without any regard of his health results, and a whole career of continually to cut people night after night after night. He may be actually mentally ill and obsessed. He might actually be obsessed with cutting people to the point that he cannot restrain or refrain from slicing people for no reason whatsoever. And it's unacceptable to have a man in your Hall of Fame who has this type of attitude and will not stop cutting people's heads open. It is unacceptable because he is not only obsessed with it, I believe he is possessed by it. And it is a disgusting, despicable revelation that he is going into the WWE Hall of Fame when Vince McMahon, you, sir, are fully aware of the damage he does, has done, and will continue to do once you induct him into your Hall of Fame. That will not stop him from continuing to cut people's heads open and to cut his own head open. And so you, sir, Vince McMahon, are a hypocrite for inducting him into your Hall of Fame.